Hi, everybody. Good evening, good evening, good evening. Welcome to Real Talk with Cindy. Come on in.
How can you forgive me when I've often gone astray? How can you think of me when I do things my way, turning my back from you, the one who loved me first, having my own desires, renewing worldly thirst? You told me you could keep me, and I should make up my mind. You tell me, come back now, but I keep wasting time, feeling so very weak. You say I can be strong. I feel I'm going too far. You tell me,
good evening,
to come home. Your love is still. Now I know this is real, and I am running back to you. I see you're standing there for me. Your arms are open wide, and I don't have to cry no more. You're standing there for me.
Good evening, good evening. How's everybody?
Why did I go away? When I know I am no good, when I'm all my own.
I'm doing good, Kelly. Thanks for joining me on tonight. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Real Talk with Cindy. I'm so glad that you're here with me on tonight, and my guest, he is here. I want to ask everyone to please remember to subscribe to my YouTube channel. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel, which is Cindy R. Barber. So please subscribe. And also, if you'd like to be a blessing to Real Talk with Cindy, my Cash App information is on the bottom of the screen. And I also would like to welcome those that will be watching the replay. Right after this, days and weeks and years from now, I want to welcome you to Real Talk with Cindy. And my special guest is Lowell Pye. And I'm going to bring him on in a couple of minutes. But please, as you're coming on, please share. Please let us know where you're from, what city and state that you're from. And please add your likes and hearts on tonight as well. Okay, everyone, please share. I'm going to bring on my special guest on tonight. Hi, Lowell.
How you doing?
I'm good. How are you doing?
I'm doing good. No complaints.
That's good. So glad to have you with me on tonight on Real Talk with Cindy. I count it an honor for you to be here with me on tonight.
Well, thank you. I'm glad to be here. Glad to be here.
Yeah. There's so much going on. I just want to get started with asking you some questions.
Okay.
And, share with us on tonight. What age did you begin singing? How old were you when you began singing?
You know, I was, I started when I was three. I started singing when I was three. The famous song, everybody always start off singing is Yes, Jesus Loves Me.
And, yeah.
In the church choir, and then I started singing with a quartet group when I was a kid, called the Junior Echoes in Detroit, Michigan. So I started singing at an early age. I'm 50 now, so 47 years of singing.
Wow, that's amazing. Yes. And of course you started in the church. And so after that point, as you started getting older in your teenage years, where where were you singing, and were you still in the church at the time?
Oh, for sure. Yes. Still in Detroit. I left Detroit in 1990. That's when I started singing with, you know, with John Key. So, but yeah, you know, all through my childhood, we had to go to church. That was a must in my mother's house. So right. I've been in church all my life. That's all I know about is church. And so we did that, and then we moved to Charlotte, North Carolina, to be with John. And then
really?
We are today. Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's when it all started. The traveling and all that good stuff. So 1990 for me.
So how did that happen when you came across being with John? Did he hear you sing in Detroit, or how did that happen?
Funny, it's a crazy story. A young lady named Tammy Haddon. Mm-hmm. We was in a group called The Right Choice that Michael Brooks from Commission had put together.
So
we had recorded that Friday night. And so mm-hmm. John was coming to Lansing, Michigan that Saturday. So she said, "Wait, look, we're going to see John. You want to go?" I said, "Yeah, I ain't doing that, so I'm going to go." So mm-hmm. we go to Lansing, see John. She mm-hmm. talks to John, said, "Hey, John, this is Lowell. He's a singer, blah, blah, blah." So he played the little demo that we did. So mm-hmm. John was like, "Well, man, I'm looking for somebody to help me sing on leads, you know, when I go out, blah, blah, blah. What you think?" So I was like, "Man, cool. Yeah, I'll do it." So I went home the next week, was in Savannah, Georgia. And the next week after that, was in Washington, D.C. And then one more city after that, then that's when I moved. Told my mother, I said, "Ma, I want to move to Charlotte to sing with John Key." So I just got accepted in DeVry Institute of Technology.
I said,
"Mom, I'm going to roll. I want to sing." And she's mm-hmm. like, "Well, okay. Well, I know you've been wanting to sing." So she let me go. I was there 19. Well, no, I was 20. Just turned 20.
Wow.
And, just turned 20. And then mm-hmm. I spent 4 years in Charlotte with John.
Wow.
Yep.
Amazing.
Yep.
And you stayed with John how long?
4 years, 1990 to 94.
Okay. Yep. What songs did you lead? Did you lead any songs with him?
Yeah, I did the second verse on "Jesus Is Real."
Oh, okay.
I did a song called "I Must Tell Jesus."
Mm-hmm.
And then me and John did another song called "You Can Make It." And so that was the three songs. I was only there for two records. And then after that's when I left in 94. Left in June of 94. Wow. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Wow, amazing.
yeah. So it's been a journey. It's been a really journey.
Yeah.
Real good journey, though, you know, I must say, because, you know, you think when you start singing, you go mm-hmm. on the road and you're singing with this guy. Back then, early 90s, John was hot as fish grease, you know what I'm saying? So he was so hot. We traveled everywhere. And I was telling somebody a few days ago, it was nothing for us to do 250 concerts a year with John.
Really?
We was, oh, man, we stayed gone. I mean, we stayed gone on the road, so. It was amazing, though. It was an amazing time. That was some good years.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So tell me about the transition when you went from John P. Key, and then you have been with Men of Standard.
Yeah, well.
How did that happen?
Well, when I left John in 94, I got married. And then, so I went and found a job. I moved to Greensboro, North Carolina.
Mm-hmm.
Started working at UPS and Sam's Club. And so that was like 1994. 95, I'm working. Early part of 96, I get a call from a lady named Talisa Stinson. Say, "Hey, Lo, we want to sign you and Isaac with a group. Can y'all find two guys?" And we're like, "Yeah, I think so." So I call Isaac. Isaac was doing a role with a play. So I call and say, "Man, we just got a deal on the table. They want us to, you know, we just got to come up with two guys." So he knew a guy that was in the play with him. We knew another guy that introduced us to a guy. And I called this guy on his job. At work, and I said, "Hey, man, we got this group." So he was like, "Yeah, I'll do it." We had never sung together,
mm-hmm.
and so when our first time singing, we got the group together. First time ever singing was "Trusting God" on the first record.
Oh yeah,
when we did, you know, the first album with Donna Lawrence produced it. That was our first time ever singing. When we sung it, it was amazing. Like, wow, it was sounding, because we had never, all of us had never sung together. Me and Isaac had sung together. Isaac had sung with Brian, but we had never sung. I never sung with Brian or Mike, but.
Right.
It just hit. And so we've been together ever since.
Wow. So how do you guys rehearse back then? How did you rehearse?
Well,
you
know, it was kind of hard. Yeah, it was kind of hard because, you know, we all lived in separate cities. different cities. So, but what we would do is we would always go to a city early. And if we came up with something that we wanted to try different, we'd get in a hotel in somebody's room and we'd just go over and stuff like that. It was really kind of hard. We rehearsed more like when we did tours with Kirk or when we did, we did a couple of tours with Fred. So they had rehearsal time for us, but it was kind of hard to just rehearse like the normal hosts. We rehearse every week. We didn't ever, we didn't do that. We didn't do that at all. We went on, we just knew our stuff. Thank the Lord. We knew our stuff. We knew our stuff and we just did it. It was, it just came out, you know, it was wonderful. You know, I think some people are meant to be together. And I think the standard before was, we was meant to be together. You know what I'm saying? And so it was great. It was really, really great. I knew I knew them. And we just had a chemistry that was amazing. That was amazing.
That's good. Especially when you're traveling like that on the road. You really have a good chemistry, you know.
Absolutely.
And, Donald Lawrence produced your first one?
Yep. Donald produced our first one. Then J Moss produced our second one.
Really?
Yeah, our third one. Noah Hall produced, and then Gerald Haddon produced our next one. Mm-hmm. The last one we did was our fifth album. Warren Campbell produced it.
What was that like working with Donald Lawrence?
Well, you know what, Donald and Warren are my favorite producers to work with. Yeah. Donald make you feel so comfortable in the studio because sometimes it's hard to just go, you know, get down on yourself because things are not happening right. And you know, you keep doing it over and over. He'd be like, "Oh, we got all day. We're in the studio. Why are you frustrated? It's like we're working." And so he would make you feel so comfortable. Warren is a genius. You know, it was his energy and his writing skills, and he taught you a lot. You know, so you was able to glean from him, just watching him work. You know, so it was good. J Moss was incredible. I love J Moss, but you know, we grew up together. So J Moss got on my nerves and we used to stack harmonies 55 times. I'm like, man, that's enough. But he was good though. He was good. Yeah. J Moss was good. Yep.
Yeah, like you said, you grew up with him, so like friends or brothers. You know?
I could go off and I can flux at him and all that kind of stuff. But it was good. We had some great producers, great songwriters and singers, and you know, just had fun. I'm just looking forward to it again.
Right. So when you all traveled, how many places did you go out of the country?
Yeah, we did. We did London. We did London like twice. We did Germany. We even went to Hawaii once. That was the craziest trip because we went to Hawaii like Thursday. It flew us in Thursday, and we was out of Hawaii like Saturday. It was like, who does a trip like that? But you know, they wanted to do it, but we went. And so those places we went. We were supposed to go to South Africa, but we weren't ready to go to South Africa. I'm not even ready to go to South Africa now. So.
Yeah.
So much going on. So much.
And then
going
with the time change in Hawaii, that had to be
It was like a 6 or 7, 6 or 8 hour difference or something in time. It was amazing, but let me tell you, that's a beautiful place. That's a beautiful place. That water is amazing.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So what transitioned you from John P. Key, then you to Men of Standard.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then after Men of Standard, then you did your own solo project. So what led you to leave Men of Standard, or what happened at the group?
Well, we just thought that it was just time for us to do some different things, not break up. You know, I believe that when you do ministry, you have assignments of people that's on your hands, on your life, you know what I'm saying? That only you can touch, you know what I'm saying? So we couldn't touch them together. We had to touch them by ourselves. Isaac had to touch them and Brian and so forth and so on. And so 2007, you know, it's just time to break away from that, do our own. And I didn't do, my first record didn't come out till 2010. You know what I'm saying? I was been working on my record for like 2 years. And so we did that. We did that, and then I did two records, solo records by myself, and just traveling by myself for a long time. And so it's been quite an experience because, you know, you're used to having two or three brothers with you on the side of you, but now you're out there by yourself. So it's like, you're looking around and, you're out there by yourself. So that was something. Yeah, so that was something to get used to, but it was cool. It's been great. I've been enjoying it. And, you know, it is what it is.
Right, know. Right.
So it's been cool. It's been cool.
Let's talk about your two solo projects that you have. Okay. A lot of people may not even know. So you have one, the first one was called Finally.
Yes.
So how did you go about putting that with the songs? Did you write songs or did you have to find writers for that and musicians? How did you do that?
The producer, his name is Alex Ward, Asif Ward. Great guy, great producer, phenomenal work. He did one of the best record I think him or Rel have ever done, Everlasting Life. He produced that record. And so phenomenal guy. So I flew to Kansas City. We talked and we just sat down and told him what direction I wanted to go in. You know, he had some songs. I wrote a few songs and it started just coming together. You know, we spent, like I told you, we spent about a year and a half working on the record because I would go up there and then stay up there a few days, then come back. You know, we wasn't ready to really put the record out. We were just kind of gathering material and just seeing what direction I want to go. When I got about two or three songs, kind of filling that out. I say, oh, no, we need to add something to this. And so that's how we did it. I didn't have a lot of writers on this song, on that first record. Have a lot of writers. I did a couple of duets and with Rance Allen, Marvin Winans, and Sherry Moffitt Jones. It was amazing. I mean, that was a great record. That was a great record. It was a great record.
Now, did you record that one in Detroit, or where did you record that one?
The first one, finally, I recorded that in Detroit and Kansas City.
Really?
Most of it in Kansas City,
Okay. Mm-hmm. Why was Kansas?
Well, because that's where the producer was from.
Oh, okay.
And he just wanted to work in his studio. He felt comfortable, more comfortable in the studio. And then when we had to go on the road, he flew to Detroit because we was under the deadline. We had to get things done. And so flew to Detroit and we worked in Detroit to finish the record up. Mm-hmm.
Someone asked, are you ever in South Carolina?
Yeah, Columbia, Greenville, Charleston, Hope. Orangeburg, I've been all over that place. South Carolina, yes.
It's my aunt. She's in Greenville.
Oh, hey, Greenville. Good. Greenville is about 2 hours from me, too.
Yeah, that's true, because you're in Atlanta.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I've been to Greenville. I've been for Pastor Johnson. Pastor Johnson. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. Tell Auntie I'm coming back.
Huh?
Tell Auntie I'm coming back.
Yeah, Auntie, he's coming back. Now, your second album, Transform, that was done in 2014. Talk about that and what made you name it Transformed, right?
Yeah, Transformed.
Okay. Yes.
I was just going through a change in my life at that time.
Okay.
You know, coming out of the old and going into the new. And I just thought, well, that would be a great title. You know, I was going through a thing with my weight loss and my journey with my weight loss and really working on that really, really heavy. So I just think, you know, transform. Nothing happens until you transform your mind.
That's it.
You can do it. I mean, you can work out and you can eat right. You can walk right. Whatever you're trying to do.
Right.
Until you make it up here in your mind that you're going to do it. That's when change happens and transformation happens. So we call it transform. And I think, you know, I love that title for that record. It was a good record. I think, you know, you always listen to it and go back and listen to your music.
Yeah.
Say, man, I should have did this better. Or I should have did that better.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
But it was cool. It, you know, it did good for me as far as making my money back what I put into it. Thank the Lord. You know, so. But that's important. But I mean, it was good. Yeah. Curtis Johnson. Mm-hmm. See? She said, she said, Curtis Johnson. Yep, that's him. Curtis Johnson.
Curtis Johnson.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Dolly McCoy's brother. That's Dolly McCoy's brother.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm.
So transformed. You were transforming, and that's why.
Transform.
So, did you write any of the songs on there?
I think I did. I wrote two on that record.
Okay.
Yeah. And then I had some other writers come in and write. You know, so I was ready to get ready. I was ready to finish that record. So I was like, come on, y'all, hurry up. Let's just work hard.
Mm-hmm.
I was such a, because I just signed a deal with E1 for distribution, and they was putting me under the gun. Like, we need to have this.
Yeah.
If you don't do this, it ain't going to come out to 15 or whatever. So I was under pressure. But we got it done, though.
But what do you think the pros and cons of being on a major record label and then just being independent?
Money, machine, you know. When you're on a label, they got the money to do what you may not have to do.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? And so it's both of them are good. You know, if you're independent and you got a little change that you can pay for your promotion and pay for radio and all that kind of stuff, that's wonderful because everything that you make come back to you. But if you don't have that, you need to sign with somebody that could kind of help you push the vision on through. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, it's, you know, pros and cons, you know, the pros and cons are, it's good to have your own, but then if you don't have what you need to have,
right,
it's good to have people who have it that can make the vision come to pass.
Absolutely.
Yep.
Absolutely. My aunt from Greenville said, I heard you sing Jesus Never Fails. And I tell you, I went all the way in.
Milo.
All right now. All the way in.
Well, thank you, Auntie Dolores, right?
Yep.
Dolores. Thank you, Auntie Dolores. Appreciate that.
So do you think, as far as, are you ready to do another single, or are you working on a project, or what are you doing now?
You know, I am working, but I, you know, when we talked before, mm-hmm. we got a surprise getting ready to happen. We've been kind of gearing up for that surprise to hit out there. So just taking my time, you know, working on me. Pandemic got everybody in shambles right now. And
that's
so
right.
I've just been kind of staying focused and staying clean. But we got some major things coming down the pipeline that I mm-hmm. think everybody's going to be excited about. So I'm really excited. Mm-hmm. Today was a great day. We had a meeting today. And today was a great day. Today was a great day. So we get ready. Next few weeks is coming out.
Okay. That sounds good. That's just rising in 3 weeks, right?
Yep.
Have you ever considered producing artists or potential artists? Have you ever considered doing that?
Yeah, I have. I think, you know, today's artists don't listen like we did when we was coming.
It's
a different breed of artists. You know, they've mm-hmm. had a level of success at their local church and their local city, and they've already arrived. So it's kind of hard to deal with people like that because they don't want to listen. Because they, you know, hey, I sing better than you, and blah blah blah. And so it's kind of hard to deal with people. But I love to help people whenever I can. You know, to get them, you know, whatever the wisdom that I've learned. I've been around some great people. When you look at John P. Key 4 years, and, you know, you've been there two tours with Kirk, and you did a tour with Fred Hammond. So you think about all the wisdom that I've been able to be around and to kind of glean from those guys. That's a lot, you know what I'm saying? So you have a lot to share. But the thing about it is you run into people, you run into artists who don't want to listen. Because, like I said, everybody's patting them on their back and everybody's telling them, man, you great, man. You are this. You awesome, man. You can sing, blah, blah, blah. Nobody want to listen. You got to always be a student of the game. Always be willing to learn. To take something from somebody. You ain't got to take all of it, but just take some meat from them.
Right.
And use it, you know, and apply it to yourself. And so it's kind of hard to find it like that. Mm-hmm. It ain't like that no more.
It's totally different. You're absolutely right. Mm-hmm. And then you have some that want to learn, but the majority of them don't. And it's kind of hard to maneuver to find the ones that really want to.
They
know it all. It's unfortunate, you know, that they're like that. Like I said, it's not everybody, but the majority of them are like that. Now, when you were working with Kirk, you said Kirk Franklin and Fred.
John Bikini.
Were they like to with
wisdom? I mean, it's always teaching, always teachable moments. It's always, you know, you have fun. It's you have fun, but it's always you're teaching. You know, you're listening to, you know, all this wisdom that's coming out of these guys.
Yeah,
you know, guys been in there 30 years and 40 years. Mm-hmm. You know, a long time working, and they're successful. So we always had an opportunity to sit at the table. You know what I'm saying? And just learn, keep our mouth closed. And just listen, you know, and we always said every tour that we did, there was always a moment backstage before the tour or before the concert started. We always get our chairs up and we just get our notepads out and just listen. You know, you think about the tour that we did with Yolanda, Donnie McClurkin, Dorinda, you know, and Fred. Man, all that wisdom, oh my God, amazing. Just learning, you know. And so those were some great, great times, great days. And so we was able to learn so we can instill that in us and then give it to somebody else. You know what I'm saying? Right. So, but you gotta want it. You gotta want to listen. You gotta want to mm-hmm. be better. You know, so you can't think that you're always there. You know, it's always somebody. My mother used to always teach me that there's always somebody better than you. There's always somebody right around the corner.
That's true.
That don't nobody know about, that'll sing rings around. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, it's like in the background and you don't know anything about him. Well, what advice would you give to aspiring singers?
Well, you know what I really always tell people, you got to learn the business. You got to realize that this is ministry, but yet it is still a business. People are in it. People are in it to make money. Record companies are in it to make money. So whenever you don't do what you want, whatever you don't do, what they think that you should do is sell them, they'll put you on the shelf. You know what I'm saying? Because it's a business to them. It ain't about, oh, Lord, shit, I got nothing on my mind. With them, they try to, you know what I'm saying? And so you have to understand that this is a business. And that's why you have to make sure that you learn it. That's why you have to surround yourself with people who are knowledgeable about the business so you can always be learning. You have to have great attorneys, great lawyers and all that kind of stuff. So when these contracts come, you know what you're doing. You're not just signing your life away because you're just so eager to sign. Be anxious for nothing, the Bible says. You know what I'm saying? Everything through prayer and supplication. Mm-hmm. You got to be careful about just signing stuff and being so, I'm about to be a recording artist. I don't know what you're doing. And you'll be looking up like, what did I just sign 20 years later? You still in that mug 20 years later. Like, how do I get out? There's no get out clause. You stuck. So I always tell people that learn this business, get your information, ask questions, learn the business. And when you learn the business, you know, God will take his stamp his approval on your gift. It will become a great success because you're learning. And not only are you learning, but you're humble. Be humble. Humble. You're not the best one. You're good, but you're not the best. You can really sing, but you're not the best.
Right.
It's some woo. Go down south for these little churches. You better sit down somewhere.
And nobody even knows anything about them.
Nobody even knows it. They just waiting on the right opportunity. Right chance. It might be your time when you up there trying to, you know, man, I'm the baddest thing on the world. Okay. Here go Joe Blow. Joe Blow about to dump your house right now, buddy. You're going to be looking like, wow. So be humble. Be willing to be teachable. You know what I'm saying? Listen. You know, then here go another good thing that artists don't do these days. Be respectful. You know, when you see these other giants and legends, man, be respectful.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You know, have your team. If you got a team, tell your team. Have the same spirit I do. I'm humble. Right. You know what I'm saying? Be respectful. Yeah. So that's the only thing I tell, you know, young people is that. And I think, you know, if they would listen to me, it'll be all right.
Yeah. And that's the thing, if they would listen.
If they would listen.
But like you said, you could go down south to some of these smaller churches and you got some tremendous singers that nobody even knows about. And they're really not trying to be anything. They just love what they do.
Just love the same. Yep. They're not trying to be artists. They just love the same.
Now, as far as like when you're doing, as far as like now, we're doing more streaming and a lot of artists are not able to travel and stuff. What are the pitfalls or the financial losses that you gain as far as the albums? Because most people now, they're making CDs, but they're not really selling CDs. They're doing more streaming. So do you find that to be a problem with artists that's coming out with a lot of artists have a lot of projects that's coming out?
So I only find that a problem if you're not writing anything, you're not going to make anything.
Okay.
That's just bottom line. Mm-hmm. See, people don't understand that once you sign a deal with a record company, you already in the red. You already owe them money. Because see, you gotta remember they paying for your record, they're paying to promote it, they're paying to fly you to promote it. And so they gotta make all that money back. And then once they make the money back that they spent for you to do the record and do the promotion and do this and that and go here and there, then they have a certain another amount of money that they wanna make as profit. See, people don't understand it. They think that once we pay this, that's their profit. No. They want to get what they made. They want to get what they spent. But then they want to make a profit. So really, 9 times out of 10, you really never see no money. Because you already in the red. You already owe them. They got to make a profit. So when they don't make a profit, they'll give you another record. And the same cycle comes again, that now you owe them for the first record. You owe them for the second record. You ain't made no money. They ain't made no profit. They ain't made no money back. Now they putting you on the shelf because, hey, we can't make no money with this person, so we ain't about to let them go because he owes us money. Tell them to give us the money back that he owes. And so you are already in the red. So that's why you got to make sure that you're writing. You're writing music, you own your publishing companies and all that kind of stuff. And once you do that, then, when you get playing and you're writing hits, then you get residuals right there. Sound Exchange and BMI and ASCII up in CSAC. You know what I'm saying? But I tell people all the time, you got to write music. You have to write music, and then you have to make yourself available to travel.
Mm-hmm. That's true. Because a lot of people, even sometimes they hear artists' songs and they think that they wrote that song.
Yep.
A lot of times writers don't get the recognition because the artist didn't write it. Somebody else wrote it. But a lot of times we do need good writers. I had David Frazier on here. He's done a master class pertaining to songwriting, do's and don'ts, and how to be a tremendous songwriter. Yeah. A lot of people, that's where most times the money is in songwriting.
Yeah.
Write the right type of songs.
Right. You got to understand, you got to have the right artist that can sing the right type of song. Because every song is not a hit. Just because you write it doesn't mean that's a hit. You know what I'm saying? So, and sometimes you can feel it. You can be like, man, this is a hit. That don't mean that it's a hit. You know what I'm saying? You writing these songs, the people determine that. You know what I'm saying? Radio determine
that. That's right.
So, we be thinking, oh man, I just want a hit. It might be a hit to you, but don't mean it's gonna be a hit that, radio, and they're gonna really pick it up. So, I just think that people have to understand that, you always in competition. I'm not saying competition in a bad way. I'm saying competition. What makes a radio station want to play your music? You know what I'm saying? Because you got all these other artists that's in front of you that they're playing. Is it mixed right? Is it master right? All that stuff plays a part. You know what I'm saying? And so a lot of times people, the quality of the music is not up to par. And then you wonder why won't nobody play it. Well, they're not going to play. If your stuff don't sound better than Kirk's, they're not going to play it. You know what I'm saying? You got a measuring stick. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And if it don't sound like Tasha Cobb's record, mix and master well, why would they pay your music? If you sound like you mastered yours in the kitchen, it's not going to work. So you got to make sure that you spend time on your music to mix it right, to get it mastered right with professionals that's what they do, not your cousin, not the hookup man down the road. No.
Right.
People that do it, check their credentials. Who have you mastered for? Who have you mixed for? It got to be right. And that's why you have to take your time and don't be in a rush. Because it has to be right.
Yeah, it does. It has to be. Especially if you want radio to play it.
Right.
Exactly. You know?
Exactly.
What is your take on internet radio?
I mean, that's where the thing is. That's where everything is going now.
Yeah.
I'll take it in a minute. It probably won't be no radio station, man. Internet radio. We look at XM and all that kind of stuff.
Right.
It's taking over.
Right. And then I know there's not a lot of people, but I know a couple of people that started their own internet radio station. They seem to be doing well with it.
Mm-hmm. It's a good thing.
Yeah. And she seems to be doing well with hers.
That's good.
Mm-hmm.
Real good.
Very good. Now, as far as this pandemic, what has it done to change you, or has it changed you in any way? The pandemic, being home, and not being able to travel like you once did.
Well, it made me appreciate the freedom that we have. United States have freedom. We can come and go as we please. It made me appreciate being outdoors and being able to go wherever I wanted to go and come back whenever I want to get ready and travel here, travel there. And when you look at other countries and other states, they don't have that kind of liberty. Some are restricted, you know, some. So it made me have a level of appreciation for my family and friends. You know, love on them more, and, you know, everybody. You know, you can be here today and gone in the morning.
Right.
You know, this stuff, I lost a lot of close friends, you know, with this, with COVID. And it just made me really, really appreciate life more. You know what I'm saying? Appreciate life more.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
What's next for Lowell?
Oh, man.
Besides the surprise, but what?
Nothing. You know, I'm just, you know, I'm working hard and daily working on me, you know, being a father to my son. I have a 22-year-old son.
Yeah.
And, being a father to him and enjoying him and looking at him grow up to be a great man and traveling still. You know, I got some years left in me to do that. I still, I love to travel, but you don't just build a life for myself after this. That's what I'm working on now.
Right.
So when this is over and slow down, I can still maintain and keep it pushing. You know what I'm saying? Yeah.
Absolutely. You're just enjoying your time.
I'm just enjoying it. Sitting at home, relaxing, enjoying this beautiful, cool air in my house. Because it's been hot here in Atlanta, Georgia. So it's been really hot. So I've been just chilling.
What would you say to musicians or singers that are a little discouraged now because their churches are not having services? What would you say to encourage them, and even singers that sing on choirs and you know, are not really singing like they were, you know, every Sunday? So what would you say to encourage them?
You're gonna think I'm crazy. I wouldn't encourage them, because with this pandemic, there's nothing that you can do about that.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You can't. This happened. Everybody suffered. You know, you just got to wait your time, do what you're supposed to do, wash your hands, wear your gloves, wear your mask. I would encourage them to do that. You're going to sing again. You know, church will be opening again. But right now, we got to do what we're supposed to do so we can live. Because if we don't, then you will never sing again. You know what I'm saying? So my encouragement was to do what they tell you to do as far as, you know, social distancing and wearing your mask and doing those things. Sing in the house. You can always sing. Sing in your car.
Mm-hmm.
Get online. You know, you got social media. Get online and sing. Let people hear you sing. You know what I'm saying? But right now, you can't be mad at this. This is what this is.
Right.
You can't do nothing about this, man.
Right.
You know,
so read and pray and study.
Yeah, that's it. That's it.
And thank God that you're still alive.
That's it.
Like I said, there's so many that have died.
And
I know quite a few. It's a lot of them that have died.
Right.
And, it's unfortunate, but it definitely has happened.
Yeah, definitely.
It definitely has happened.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I want to thank you for being my guest.
Oh, I'm so happy.
I really am very happy that you came to be a part. And I don't know. I think you remember Mike Barnes. He says, "Hey, love.
What up, Mike? What up, bro?" I see you, boy. What's going on?
Now, could you sing something for us before we leave?
It's going to be real little, I'll tell you.
Yes.
Ooh, one of these mornings. No, I'm joking. I won't give up on giving.
Ooh.
I'm holding on till the end. I will be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in you. Lord, I am staying in your will.
Wow, that was real short. Was nice.
Where you go?
I wanted you to be on the platform.
Oh my!
Like you on the stage. I want you to feel at home.
Oh, okay. I appreciate that. Thank you so much.
Wow, that was great.
Thank you.
I was ready for some more.
No,
I want to push it.
Look at you.
I want to push it.
Look at you. Somebody say amen. Thank you, Sister Stacy.
Yeah, that was Stacy. And this is my sister-in-law, Kathy. She said, love that song. Same brother.
Thank you, Sister Kathy. I appreciate that.
It wasn't long enough.
Thank you. Yes, it was. It was good. Marcus. Thank you, bro. I appreciate it. They go auntie. They go auntie now.
Auntie's that too short.
Oh, come on, auntie.
She's a singer too.
Really? Okay. Awesome.
Oh, yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Now, if it's one person that you always maybe wanted to sing with, who would that person be? Can you think of? Because I know you.
You know, somebody like I wouldn't mind doing a duet with like Fantasia.
Okay.
Let me see. Charlie Wilson.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm a music lover, you know, so I like music, you know.
Yeah.
And like he's one of my favorites. Joe is one of my favorites. Mm-hmm. And what I would have loved, the ultimate for me would have been able to sit down with Donny Hathaway.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
I would have been in heaven, man.
Yeah.
Malo.
Yeah, he was a tremendous singer.
Ooh, man.
And his music still sounds good.
Oh, my God. It's amazing.
And it's his amazing. Daughter. Oh, my gosh.
Mm-hmm.
A person I always wanted to meet was Andre Crouch.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
That, I had. I just used to love Andre, his writing. And he's like a nice person.
Yes, Lord. That man can write. Oh, my God.
Mm-hmm.
One of my favorite songs he wrote before he died was I'll Never Leave You.
Yes.
Thank you, even though you've been with me. Ooh, that was a wonderful album. Jeez.
Wasn't it?
That was a wonderful record.
It was. Wow.
Yeah.
So, Lowell, you can't just give one more and then we'll.
No.
We said don't push it, right?
Yeah.
Well, I was trying. Frederick.
Huh? I'm reading with you.
Yes. He says I'm one of forever favorites. Yes. Frederick, definitely. Freddie Bauer.
There you go.
Yeah.
What up, Fred?
Yeah. He's a phenomenal organist.
Oh, really?
This is my brother who's watching.
Hey, Miss Naomi.
Yeah, she supports well.
That's
my
good.
Family supports well.
Awesome. One more. Oh, Sister Stacy, you ought to be shaming y'all soon.
No, not really.
Daily I shall worship you, Lamb of God who died for you, who extended endless mercies. Daily I shall worship thee. So Jesus, use me. Don't refuse me, for still there's a work that I can do. Though it's humble, let my will, let it crumble. Though the cost be great, I'll work for you. Though the cost be great, I'll work for you. So draw me nearer. Nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Ooh. To thy precious bleeding side.
Oh, Lowell, thank you so much. That was wonderful. It was a little medley.
Oh, my God. Look at you.
Very nice. Well, I want to thank all of those that are watching and
thank
those
you.
That watch the replay. And Stacy says here, thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you.
And I look forward to interviewing you again, hopefully next year.
Good day.
And
I want to break the news to your audience.
Okay, so when you get it,
we'll set it up. Okay, good day.
We'll set it up. Definitely.
Okay. All right.
And I want to thank all of those that are watching and those that will watch the replay and those that are watching on YouTube. Thank you so much for being a part of Real Talk with Cindy. Join me again on this coming Thursday night. I will be back with I have a special guest and a soloist on Thursday night. So please join me on Thursday. My aunt is saying, enjoyed you, Lowell.
Thank you so much, Auntie. I appreciate it. Thank you.
My mother said, thank you so much.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Yes. See, everybody, they would have missed it. Sing for us tonight.
Thank you. Well, I did the best I could do tonight.
You did. You did. Beyond being the best. It was very good.
Thank
you. Good night to everyone. Lowell, you hold on. And okay. I'm going to say good night. Frederick Bauer says, thank you so much. Enjoyed the hymns, Lowell.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
So good night, everyone, and God bless.